Rape is a horrific crime that often goes unsolved, leaving victims with no sense of justice.
Tonight, the King 5 investigators exposed that police departments across the state could be doing more to help solve these crimes. In her continuing report, Linda Byron finds thousands more rape kits containing DNA evidence are not being tested.
Step one is the toxicology, so we can collect urine and blood. And then next is the trace debris.
At emergency rooms like this one at Evergreen Health in Kirkland, specially trained sexual assault nurses are on hand 24/7 to support rape victims and to collect evidence that may have been left behind by a perpetrator. Being photographed, swabbed, and examined in a 15-step, 4-hour process can be emotionally difficult for someone who's been through a violent crime like rape.
I think no matter what, they do feel re-victimized slightly.
But nurse Susan Johnson says most victims are willing to do it for one key reason.
They want the kit to be tested. They want to know if it matches somewhere. They watch CSI. They see how these things get tracked and want that for themselves.
It's up to police to submit the rape kits to the Washington State Patrol Crime Lab, where forensic scientists examine the evidence and tease out the DNA belonging to an alleged rapist.
Those results go into a system called CODIS, the Combined DNA Index System, a huge national database run by the FBI containing DNA profiles.
If there's a hit, it means the DNA from the rape kit matches the profile of a convicted offender or suspect that was previously entered into CODIS.
So you can see with our evidence profile and comparing it to suspect one, every single one of these numbers match up.
But the lab can't test what it never gets. And the King 5 investigators have learned the vast majority of rape kits in Washington are still sitting in evidence rooms. In November, we obtained Seattle Police Department records. Out of more than 1,600 rape kits collected over a decade, only 365 were ever sent to the lab, leaving nearly 1,300 untested on the shelf. A statewide survey is now underway to find out how many untested rape kits are out there.
Based so far, how many unsubmitted rape kits have been reported?
About 4,500.
And do you expect that it will be going at least to 5,000, 6,000?
At least 5,000. Probably I could easily say 6,000 beyond that.
And the Washington State Crime Lab predicts the number could be much higher.
Seeing patterns.
That worries victim advocates like Mary Ellen Stone, director of King County Sexual Assault Resource Center.
The justice system needs to be as responsive to victims as it can possibly be. Where we get concerned, where I get really concerned about rape kits not being tested for whatever reason, is that that sends a very, I think, dismissive message to victims.
SPD says there are valid reasons not to test the kits if they already know who the suspect is or prosecutors don't plan to charge.
So we basically have a...
Here's what the department said 2 months ago when we questioned why they submit only one out of every five rape kits to the lab.
The Seattle Police Department is absolutely comfortable in our practices, our protocols, and our policies surrounding evidence collection, specifically to sex crimes.
But just today, SPD made a U-turn.
We're looking at testing all sexual assault kits moving forward, and we basically are working with our partners in constant communication with the prosecutor's office, victim advocacy groups, the Sexual Assault Network, to ensure that what we're doing is the gold standard.
Advocates say most rape victims thought police were already doing that. It's why they're willing to go through that 4-hour exam to begin with.
The power that was taken from them during the sexual assault, it gives them the power to know that they can prosecute this person.
Linda Byron, King 5 News.
Tomorrow in Olympia, there is a hearing on a proposed law that will require police to send all rape kits to the state lab for testing going forward. The law also calls for a work group to figure out what to do about the backlog of old rape kits that were never tested. Much of the evidence collected during rape investigations in our state is never sent to the crime lab for analysis. Today, a group of lawmakers heard testimony on a proposed law that would require timely testing of rape kit evidence. As Linda Byron reports, the most powerful testimony came from an Ohio prosecutor.
This is the one project in all my years as being a prosecutor, as a law enforcement officer, that I have seen such wild, successful results.
Special Investigations Prosecutor Rick Bell flew halfway across the country to tell Washington lawmakers what happened when Ohio began testing rape kits that were gathering dust on police evidence shelves. Bell says in the greater Cleveland area alone, they realized they had dozens of rapists going free.
And we have indicted 244 people. This is amazing. This is leading the country right now.
Ohio did it by taking DNA from thousands of untested rape kits and putting it into a national FBI database of convicted offenders and suspects, a database called CODIS.
Of our investigations, we've determined that 30% of the 244 that we've indicted so far are serial rapists.
Representative Tina Orwal worries that serial rapists are going free in Washington because key evidence that might tie them to unsolved crimes never reaches the State Patrol Crime Lab and is never put into that federal database. Orwal's proposing legislation that would stop the practice of leaving rape kits sitting in police storage rooms.
Within 30 days, we want them to send to the lab, and we want to work at giving our state lab additional resources so they can process those quickly.
Rape exams are done on over 2,000 victims a year in Washington, mostly by specially trained forensic nurses. Critics say testing all of those rape kits won't necessarily lead to more convictions and could overwhelm an already overworked crime lab.
We think it functionally doesn't accomplish anything. It certainly accomplishes moving these kits to another location, but they won't go into the queue any faster.
But this is happening across the country, and rapists are being convicted, some based on DNA evidence 10, even 20 years old, that is only now being tested. Orwal's bill only requires rape kits collected going forward to be sent to the crime lab, and that within 30 days, and only if the victim consents.
So, Linda, what about all of those kits that are now sitting on the shelf?
They don't know quite yet what to do about those, but the bill does call for a work group that would look at that. They think there are about 5,000 to 6,000 of those that are untested, and they want to come up with a way to go back and start looking at them.
All right, Linda, thanks. Okay.
The Seattle Police Department announces a major change in how it will handle evidence collected from rape victims.
The change comes after a King 5 investigation revealed the department has more than 1,200 untested rape kits sitting in storage. King 5 investigator Linda Byron joins us now with the latest developments on this.
So our investigation found that many rape victims are not getting their chance at justice because SPD was sending only 22% of the rape kits they'd collected over the past decade to the state crime lab. Now, the lab is where the DNA of an alleged perpetrator taken off the victim gets entered into an FBI database to see if it matches a known offender. SPD had a policy of only sending rape kits to the lab if they knew prosecutors planned to file charges. In November, the police department revised that, telling us they would test all rape kits moving forward. Then today, the police department took it a step further, saying they will also test a backlog of 1,276 old rape kits that had just been sitting on the shelf. The King County Sexual Assault Resource Center commended that decision, saying it sends a clear and a positive message to victims that reporting matters. Now, keep in mind, it can take 4 hours for a rape exam to take place, mm-hmm. and rape victims and advocates say it's disrespectful to then have that evidence just go to a police department and sit on a shelf gathering dust.
And again, this is a step beyond what many people expected.
That's right, and there are thousands of these across the state. Seattle isn't the only jurisdiction that is grappling with this.
All right, Linda, thanks. Okay.
There is new hope for rape victims seeking justice in Washington state.
Today, the governor signed a new law that requires the testing of all rape kits moving forward. King 5 investigator Linda Byron first exposed that thousands of rape kits were just sitting untested in evidence rooms statewide, and her investigation led to this new law. So tell us what this law will do.
Well, Lori, the biggest impact will be on rape kits collected in the future because all of them must be submitted for testing within 30 days. And the law also begins to tackle the huge backlog of thousands of old rape kits.
Appreciate everybody's leadership on their efforts to fight this scourge.
With a flourish of a pen, Governor Jay Inslee reverses a statewide practice of letting most evidence collected in rape cases go untested. In the future, all rape kits must be sent for forensic testing, and any DNA results put into a national FBI database of convicted felons and cold cases. Similar laws in other states have led to hundreds of offenders being arrested, many of them serial rapists.
I think we're going to see the same pattern, and we're going to realize there's some very dangerous offenders on our streets that really should be in jail or prison.
A King 5 investigation revealed a backlog of some 6,000 untested rape kits statewide. The Seattle Police Department alone had nearly 1,300 and a record of sending only one of every five rape kits for testing. Rape exams can take over 4 hours and be emotionally grueling for victims. Advocates say the least police can do is get that evidence tested.
Rape victims need justice. They've had a violent crime perpetrated upon them, and rape kits are the number one way for finding out and prosecuting their attackers.
Across the state, there are five Washington State Patrol labs, including this one in Seattle, that process DNA collected in rape kits. All of them are bracing for an influx of cases.
Last year, the labs processed about 1,000 rape kits. They're expecting double or even triple that number this year.
We are enthusiastic that we can help more sexual assault investigations, and hopefully we'll get, make streets a little safer.
The new law includes $2.7 million for testing new rape kits. As for the old cases, the lab would be overwhelmed if all 6,000 came in at one time, and there is no money yet to test them. But the Washington State Association of Police Chiefs and Sheriffs applied for a $2 million Department of Justice grant last week, and Representative Orwell is asking police departments like SPD to also apply for similar funding, and tonight SPD tells me they will be following up on that.
That's really good news, and congratulations.
Thank you.
Starting July 1st, rape victims in our state know that the evidence collected in their cases will actually be tested. That's thanks to a new law requiring police to send rape kits to the State Patrol Crime Lab within 30 days.
But that law only helps victims who can get a rape kit done in the first place. And King 5 investigator Linda Byron found that can be a big challenge.
Rape victims usually go to the closest emergency room for help, yet we found most hospitals aren't set up to do their exams or to collect rape kits.
The first several months were really hard. I lost about 20 pounds. I was unable to keep down any food.
This Seattle teacher says last spring, she became a statistic. She'd gone out with a girlfriend in Ballard and stopped into a neighborhood bar on her way home.
Started talking to this guy. I went to the restroom and left my drink, and 15 minutes later, I barely remember anything.
She asked us to interview her in shadow because of what she says happened next.
I remember walking down the street and specifically telling him that I did not want to have sex with him. I remember being on his bed with my feet bound together, and I remember pain and stabbing sensations, and then saw a pool of blood and ran out the door.
The teacher told police she believed she'd been drugged and raped.
I managed to call a friend who found me standing in the intersection and took me home.
Hours later, she drove to the closest emergency room, Swedish Ballard.
They told me that they do not provide rape kits there. They did not find my injury, and then they sent me out the door.
What happened to her isn't unique. There are some 90 hospital emergency rooms across our state. Yet only a small fraction are staffed with the specially trained nurses who do rape exams and collect evidence in rape kits.
Estimates that we can find are somewhere around 10% in our state. Nationwide, their estimates are about 13%.
Susan Johnson is past president of the Washington chapter of International Forensic Nurses. They're pushing to have a trained nurse in every ER to examine rape victims.
They want to be believed, and they want to, they're coming there with everything that they have to get into the emergency room, and then to be told that they can't be helped there. It just takes a lot out of them emotionally to have to go someplace else.
Some victims give up, Others will drive to another hospital to get a rape kit done. All the while, the clock is ticking for collection of time-sensitive evidence.
It is worth it to go pursue quality, sophisticated, specialized care.
The Washington State Hospital Association says having a forensic nurse in every hospital isn't the answer.
Because it's not just the training, it's the experience that matters. You want somebody who's good at it. And in healthcare, experience really matters. If you're looking for a facility or a physician to do something like a knee replacement, what you would ideally know is how many knee replacements does this doctor do?
In the case of the Seattle teacher, Swedish referred her to Harborview, the only Seattle hospital staffed with a forensic nurse to do a rape kit. She drove herself there, but not until the next day, after sleeping, taking a shower, and calming down. According to her medical records, Harborview found bruises and a cut in her vagina, possibly caused by a foreign object. The delay in getting that kit done would have a big impact on her quest for justice.
And the examination wasn't done, at least until a full day later, when really valuable evidence gets lost. So that sort of is a fact for us in the case that really makes prosecution enormously difficult.
Chief Criminal Deputy Mark Larson says because the alleged attacker claimed the sex was consensual, to charge rape, they would have to prove the teacher was forced or too incapacitated to give consent. But the rape kit was collected too late to pin down the timing of the drug found in her body, an antidepressant she says she doesn't take, a drug that can cause memory loss when mixed with alcohol.
We had no way of saying how or under what circumstances that drug may have been put into her system.
Also missing, any evidence that might have linked her alleged attacker to other crimes when put into a national DNA database.
The rape kit was examined. No male DNA or profile was found analyzed. However, bear in mind that the rape kit wasn't collected for the better part of 2 days after the event.
If the kit isn't done, there's no way of linking the perpetrator to that crime.
Representative Tina Orwell sponsored the new law that says every rape kit must be tested and establishes a committee to help victims get help faster.
We don't want a victim to have to get in a car and travel 40 minutes or not go in and have the rape kit conducted. You know, again, there's no justice for that victim. There's no ability to catch a serial rapist when we aren't helping them at that moment.
The changes could help future victims.
I ended up
but
waiting.
This Seattle teacher is left wondering why she endured the 5-hour exam at all.
It would be nice to know that when you lay on this bed in this room in front of all these people and they swab and take photographs of your naked body, that evidence was for something.
Swedish still doesn't have a forensic nurse on staff, but now arranges for Harborview's nurse to do rape exams at the Swedish ER on First Hill when necessary. Harborview is providing that same service to Seattle Children's and hopes to begin covering the UW, Northwest Hospital, and Valley Medical at some point in the future.
Rape victims usually go to the emergency room for help, but the King 5 investigators found victims being turned away because most hospitals in our state don't do rape exams.
Senator Patty Murray says that's extremely troubling, and tonight speaks exclusively with Linda Byron about the changes she's demanding.
I remember being on his bed with my feet bound together, and I remember pain and stabbing sensations.
This Seattle teacher says after being drugged and raped in Ballard, she went to the nearest hospital to get examined and to get a rape kit done. But instead of getting the help she needed, she got the brush off.
They told me that they do not provide rape kits there. They did not find my injury, and then they sent me out the door.
What happened to her isn't unusual. It's estimated only one out of every 10 hospitals in Washington has a specially trained forensic nurse on staff or on call to do rape kits.
I was stunned. I thought that every hospital, every provider was prepared to help somebody who was raped with staff that was trained with rape kits and what they needed.
In fact, rape victims are often told they will have to go to another hospital, sometimes miles away, to get a rape exam done. In May, the Washington State Hospital Association defended that practice.
Because it's not just the training, it's the experience that matters. You want somebody who's good at it, and in healthcare, experience really matters.
I am not buying that. I'm absolutely not buying that.
In a strongly worded letter to the Hospital Association, Senator Patty Murray calls the situation extremely troubling and demands an action plan to ensure that hospitals do a better job of helping sexual assault survivors, including making rape exams more available.
I would say to the Hospital Association, step up and do the right thing right now. But if they're not willing to do that, then I will look at every option of how we can make this happen.
Victims advocates say the answer is a trained forensic nurse in every hospital so that traumatized victims don't suffer more from a system that should be helping them or give up altogether, which can mean a rapist walking free.
In a written statement, the Hospital Association said it's working with a state legislative task force to ensure that sexual assault victims get the care they need and deserve. That includes ensuring that if they need to be transferred to another hospital, it's done easily and in a supportive way. Linda Byron, King 5 News.
Imagine being raped and having the evidence left on the shelf. It's happened to thousands of victims in our state, but under a new law, all rape kits will be tested moving forward.
The law also sets up a committee to figure out what to do about old rape kits sitting in storage. As King 5 investigator Linda Byron reports, there's one police department that is not waiting to act.
I think it's a lot of cases. These cases are just screaming for attention. You know, they just need to be pulled off the shelf. They need somebody to look through them with a new set of eyes.
Whether it was a child abducted 35 years ago.
This is a 1980 case, and this is a case involving a 13-year-old girl who was reported missing, and she was later found sexually assaulted and murdered.
Or a woman raped by a stranger.
Not a lot of good information.
Detective Lindsay Wade never gives up hope of finding the person who did it.
Yep, absolutely. Somebody knows what happened.
Her passion is tracking down predators who rape and sometimes kill. Because with every victim, there's a family desperate to learn what happened.
You know, I get calls from family members all the time wanting to know, hey, can you just, look at my case again? Can you look at my daughter's case again?
Those calls motivate Wade to tackle.
These are all old cases.
A detective's toughest job.
That I requested out of our records archives.
Reviewing cold cases.
Sexual assault cases.
Digging for overlooked evidence, especially DNA.
Other than identical twins, no one has the same DNA profile. So if your DNA shows up at a crime scene or in a rape kit, then you've got some explaining to do.
In many cases, the DNA was never tested, or it could be retested using new technology.
I've done a lot of DNA work on this case.
One of the cases that really bothered Wade was a Pierce County rape from 1995.
Nameless composite drawing person.
The rape of a 9-year-old girl.
Pretty horrific.
A man had lured the child to his car as she was walking to school in Buckley.
Threw her into the vehicle, tied her up, and drove her over 30 miles to a wooded area where she was sexually assaulted brutally and then left in the woods.
Reviewing the case, Wade was startled to see that the rape kit had never been sent to the lab.
So this is one of the freezers in the Pierce County property room that contains rape kits from the Tacoma Police Department and the Pierce County Sheriff's Department.
When Wade came looking in this property room, she was skeptical she would find what she needed.
Given how old it was like 17 years after the fact, I think. So I was just ecstatic that the kit was still there.
Wade had it sent to the Washington State Patrol Crime Lab, where scientists identified a DNA profile and entered it into CODIS, the federal DNA database. There was a hit.
A serial offender who had history for committing similar crimes.
Wade had her suspect.
Who was already in the CODIS database.
And not just any suspect.
You had investigated him previously.
Yes.
And sent him to prison.
Yes.
And when you found out that he was responsible for this 1995 child rape?
Yes.
What was your reaction?
I about fell out of my chair.
His name was Donald Victor Schneider.
I couldn't believe it. He was never documented on a police report or in a contact as being in that location. He was never documented to own the type of vehicle that was used in this incident. So, I mean, he just was not on the radar at all.
And if you hadn't gotten that rape kit tested, he would have gotten away with it.
Absolutely, yes.
Schneider was already in prison for kidnapping and raping a woman in 2007.
He was brought back to Pierce County, and he ended up pleading guilty and went back to prison, where he's now serving his second life sentence.
That success encouraged Wade to look at more of what's in this property room.
Even though some of these rape kits have been sitting on the shelves for years, because they're stored in these refrigerated evidence lockers, the DNA has been preserved.
Hoping for the magic of DNA, Wade sent dozens more rape kits to the lab and got back DNA profiles for 20 suspects, 14 matched offenders already in CODIS, including this man, Andre Jones Taylor, a registered sex offender in prison for trying to kidnap a woman in 2012. DNA hits tied him to two unsolved cases 9 years earlier, the rape of a woman in McKinley Park in July 2003, and the rape of a woman walking home along Yakima Avenue 4 months later. Taylor was charged with both rapes and is currently awaiting trial. And Wade, she's not finished. Every rape kit in this freezer, every binder in this room holds someone's story.
You know, it's hard every time a family member calls you to just have to tell them, you know, sorry, I got nothing for you. I got nothing.
Detective Wade never gives up hope she can help write the final chapter.
When you do get that positive result, being able to call a family member and tell them, hey, we've solved it, is just so rewarding. These are really old reports.
A federal grant is funding a lot of the work Wade is doing. Now, it took Tacoma PD 4 tries to get the $225,000 award from the National Institute of Justice. But in addition to catching those serial rapists, the grant has helped Tacoma solve 24 homicides.
A woman is raped, a horrifying experience. She then undergoes an invasive exam in hopes of prosecuting the crime, only to have the evidence sit on a shelf.
A joint USA Today and Tegna Media investigation looked at police departments nationwide. They found tens of thousands of rape kits have never been tested, letting rapists go free and leaving victims with no hope. King 5's Linda Byron has more on a story new at 10.
There was the ideal family. I guess we had that life.
That changed for Debbie Smith of Williamsburg, Virginia, when a stranger dragged her into the woods and raped her.
I just went into total shock. I couldn't make myself believe what was going on.
I noticed my front door is slightly cracked.
This Charlotte, North Carolina woman was barely 20 when she was raped by a man in a ski mask.
It's very devastating when you're that age and someone violates you and rapes you like that in your home.
Danielle Tudor was raped when she was a senior in high school by Portland's so-called jogger rapist.
He basically was hunting me down in my own home.
All three reported the crime and went to the hospital for a rape exam, an exam that can seem nearly as traumatic as the crime.
It destroys what you even have left of your self-esteem, but you do it because you know that it will give you hope.
Hope that when the kit is tested, scientists will find a DNA profile they can enter into a national database. Yet a USA Today Tegna investigation found police departments nationwide failing to give victims their chance for justice. Records obtained from 800 police agencies reveal they're holding more than 70,000 untested rape kits, including more than 1,900 in Portland, 1,700 in Phoenix, and 1,200 in Virginia Beach. After learning Seattle was testing just 1 out of every 5 rape kits, State Representative Tina Orwell pushed through a new law requiring all be tested moving forward.
There's no way of knowing if you have a serial rapist unless you're testing all kits.
Where old kits are being tested, the results are dramatic. Houston just cleared a backlog of more than 6,000 rape kits, leading to charges in 41 rapes where no one had been held accountable.
It did happen, unfortunately, and we are eagerly looking forward to prosecuting those rapists.
One's been convicted and sentenced to 40 years, another to 45. In Cleveland, Testing rape kits linked more than 200 alleged serial rapists to 600 assaults. Since Colorado passed a mandatory testing law, they've had more than 200 DNA hits.
So this is one of the freezers in the Pierce County property room that contains rape kits.
In Tacoma, Washington, a rape kit from a 9-year-old girl sat untested for 17 years before a detective discovered it. The DNA matched a serial rapist who pled guilty and was sentenced to life in prison.
The offender is not out walking the street. She's never going to see him again, and he's never going to hurt anybody else.
Congress just approved $41 million in grants to police to help clear rape kit backlogs, money that could help catch others like the Portland jogger rapist, the Charlotte ski mask rapist, and the man who dragged Debbie Smith into the woods, all now in prison.
The very least that we can do is to test that kit for them, to have gone through that exam, and then to take that exam and put it behind a locked door is a travesty.
In Seattle, Linda Byron, King 5 News.
Our investigation also found many police departments have no idea how many untested rape kits they have in their property rooms. Out of all 50 states, only 10 are legally required to track them. Six more states are going back and counting them voluntarily, even though they're not required to.
A King 5 investigation continues to prompt action. We first revealed that police statewide are holding some 6,000 rape kits that were never sent for testing. That includes hundreds of rape kits in King County. Now, Councilmember Rod Dombrowski is asking for money to review them. King 5 investigator Linda Byron was given exclusive behind-the-scenes access as Dombrowski toured King County's property room to get a first-hand look at the evidence.
We're doing everything we can to bring justice to that victim.
Inside this nondescript warehouse in South King County.
Anything you can possibly think of is in this building.
Amazing. Oh, yeah.
The King County Sheriff escorts Councilmember Rod Dombrowski past thousands of pieces of evidence collected in crimes ranging from theft to murder. But their destination is a huge cold storage locker where rape kits are kept. Some dating back more than a decade.
The hospital is, does their examination, everything like that. They put it in vials, they put it in little bags.
The evidence in these rape kits was collected at hospitals from victims who reported being raped, then agreed to invasive, traumatic exams, hoping for justice. Typically, police take custody of the rape kits, then send them to the Washington State Patrol Crime Lab for DNA analysis. Yet nearly 400 of these rape kits have never left the freezer, a practice Sheriff Urquhart defends.
395 have not been tested, that's correct.
Why not?
Because the detective on the case determined that there was no probative value from testing those particular kits.
Do you still agree with that?
Yes.
But the council member sees it differently.
National stories and your work locally have shown the importance of taking a second look at untested kits for their evidentiary value. They've solved additional crimes, and that's something that we're interested in doing here.
This week, Dombrowski will submit a proposal to his colleagues on the budget committee asking for $200,000 for experts to review all of the untested kits and recommend which one should go to the crime lab.
Why not test all of them?
If that's what the experts tell us we should do, Linda, we will. But we want to take a look at and understand what the best approach is. And if that's what the recommendation is, we'll find a way to do that.
Urquhart says it's not as simple as just sending the kits to the lab.
The simplest thing for me to do would be to take them from here and send them to the State Patrol Crime Lab. So then rather than sitting on my shelf, they can sit on the shelf at the State Patrol Crime Lab that doesn't have the resources to test them.
The crime lab is about to get a big infusion of money, $2.75 million to hire more forensic scientists. The money's part of a new law that took effect in June, requiring all rape kits be tested moving forward. Representative Tina Orwell sponsored the law and commends King County for taking action on its own.
Well, I do appreciate King County really coming forward on this issue and their leadership looking at what's going to happen with those kits. My hope is that it's not just reviewing whether they should proceed on kits, but it's moving forward with the best practice, which is to test the kits.
Orwell says only by entering DNA taken from rape kits into a national crime-solving database can police and prosecutors connect the dots on the worst offenders, the serial rapists.
You can't, on a case-by-case basis, connect someone to other crimes without uploading the DNA.
Dembowski says he came to see the rape kits firsthand because each one has a name, a story, and the right to know they're not forgotten. Linda Byron, King 5 News.
At a budget committee meeting tomorrow morning, Dembowski will officially ask for $200,000 to review rape kits.
The Washington State Crime Lab is scrambling to handle a big influx of rape kits coming in since a new law took effect last summer.
The law says every rape kit must be tested, whereas in the past, most were left sitting in property rooms. King 5 investigator Linda Byron is here with a look at what she's discovered.
So what we learned is if the crime happened after the new law took effect in July, the rape kit will be tested. But justice is still on hold for thousands of other victims because the crime lab says it lacks resources.
Appreciate everybody's leadership on their efforts to fight this scourge. And with that, I'm signing the bill.
The new law requires police to submit every rape kit for testing within 30 days of collection. It means a lot of extra work for the already busy State Patrol Crime Lab.
We're definitely seeing an impact. We have 5 DNA casework laboratories throughout the state. And looking across the division for all 5 labs, we've seen about an 86% increase.
Those labs typically test rape kits in batches to maximize efficiency. And testing one batch can take a week. The legislature provided $2.75 million to offset the increased workload, but that's less than half what the State Patrol asked for.
Yes, it's critical.
Jean Johnston, who manages all that DNA evidence, says the money's enough to hire 7 more scientists to handle the influx of new rape kits, but not enough to address the backlog of old rape kits that are sitting in evidence lockers all over the state.
We just don't have the staff to be able to handle, it's estimated, I think, about 5,000 to 6,000 unsubmitted sexual assault kits, and these go back for a decade or more.
All right, thanks, everybody.
Last January, months before the new law took effect, the Seattle Police Department announced a major policy change. Where they had been sending just 1 out of every 5 rape kits for testing, they would now be submitting all of them, including nearly 1,300 in storage going back years.
Throughout the process of changing our policies, we had been in regular meetings with the crime lab, and they had assured us that capacity was not going to be an issue.
But after testing just a few dozen of the old rape kits, the crime lab said no more.
I had an inkling that perhaps once the kits started going in that there would be some issues, but I was caught by surprise that there was kind of a bright line set of when the law passed, which left a lot of our cases that we'd already sent over in limbo.
Because basically they said anything before the law is going to be put on hold.
Right.
And that's the bulk of your rape kits.
That's the bulk of the kits that we still had, yeah.
While it sounds like a setback, Representative Tina Orwell, who sponsored the rape kit legislation, says the crime lab did the right thing.
I actually think that it was a good idea to send them back. We really are trying to have our state lab focus currently on the new kits moving forward, and that we're going to need different strategies for the older kits.
Other cities have cleared backlogs by going after corporate donations and federal grants to pay for testing in private labs. Orwell was hoping SPD would do the same when it changed its policy last January.
I know there'll be federal dollars available next year, and I hope they will help us out. It would be great if they applied for a grant or partnered in helping other jurisdictions, but we also need their help securing these private funds as well. So we need them. We need them to be heroes and come to the table and work with us.
Is the police department committed to going out and applying for federal grants and looking for private money, whatever it's going to take?
I think we're committed to doing whatever it's going to take to get the backlog cleared and to get the backlog tested. What that's going to look like moving forward, I don't know.
Orwell says the law that requires all rape kits be tested in the future is a big win, but she won't be satisfied until every victim gets answers.
You know, it's such a personal violation, and the stories are just heart-wrenching. And, you know, when I've talked to victims, maybe 20 years, but they're still not feeling safe. They still feel pain. And so I think there's a lot of people that are quietly suffering that really deserve justice.
Justice that could be unlocked by opening a box of evidence that was collected during an invasive exam, only to be sealed and put on a shelf.
Representative Orwell plans to ask the legislature for more money to test about a quarter of the statewide backlog. And she is urging police departments to go after federal money. Tacoma did it with remarkable results using a $225,000 grant from the National Institute of Justice. Tacoma sent old rape evidence in for DNA testing and wound up charging a half dozen serial rapists.
Wow, it's a big number.
It is. It's quite a success story.
Long way to go here. Thanks, yes. Linda.